been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead for 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upwards and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." For the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Please be seated.
Let us pray. Jesus wept and he said to him, "Unbind him and let him go." Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, a rock and redeemer. Amen. Greetings to you all in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. May the good Lord bless you and keep you all in peace. Amen. I began to read Bible, the scripture, before I went to theological studies. I used to look at the Bible and read from my own personal experiences, from my own personal needs and emotions. And I understood the scripture, which spoke to me so personal to me. When I went to the theological college, at the seminary, I began to read the scripture with a lens to see and to read and understand the scripture from a socio-political perspective, where my eyes got open to the realities of the world, to the realities of war, discrimination, poverty, and so on. So I began to read and understand the scripture in many ways, and I also used many hermeneutical tools to interpret the scripture, and one of that was a socio-political way of looking at the scripture and understanding it. So I used to preach, I used to write mostly from a post-colonial perspective. Then after I left the seminary, when I went to the church again, I began to serve in rural parishes where people's life were so hard and difficult. I lived with people who sometimes have only money in their pocket only to feed for them for that day, for that evening. So these hermeneutical tools did not come there. I began to read the scripture, began to understand and interpret the scripture from the life experiences of my people with whom I lived there. I moved to Germany. It didn't have much effect there. Then I moved to Australia here, and now I began to read scripture in a different way. Along with you, with your life experiences and realities, and also different socio-political and socio-religio-cultural contexts that we are living in today in Australia here. And here we have a Bible passage from John chapter 11, which is a popular one, the resurrection of Lazarus. We know this story very well. And today I would like to read this scripture along with you to reflect again from a different perspective. Last Sunday we also meditated from the life and book of Job. And it gave an insight saying that the book of Job, the life of Job, makes us to ask so many questions, or it provokes us to ask questions, and these questions are usually cannot be answered. We cannot find answers for these questions. So such difficult questions this book of Job and life of Job gave us. And here also we are reading a passage which also reading in today's context, in today's lives, will also ask us or make us to ask more questions. And I would like to ask a few questions from this passage. The first thing that we can observe here is Jesus, he knew what was happening there. He also delayed going to Mary, Martha and Lazarus' house even after hearing that he was sick. He also came to know that he was dead already, and it's been 4 days already. And let us imagine a situation today where we have to go to a funeral service, and we didn't get a flight to fly to the next city or another city to attend the funeral service, and we missed the funeral service. There are two options for us. One, we may think, okay, the man is gone. What's the use of me now going there? I don't need to go. Or even my friend would understand if I when I didn't attend the funeral office, so he would understand, or his family would understand. So there is an option that, okay, it is okay not to go there. And if someone would feel so close to this person, even if he or she couldn't attend the funeral service, would still have in mind, okay, at least I would go to the place, go where he was buried, or where he was cremated, or where his ashes are spread, so that at least I go and keep some flowers there and I would come. Here Jesus, he goes to this place after 4 days. So the question is, why did Jesus go there after 4 days? Not after 4 days, after knowing that he was dead already for 4 days. It's not, we knew at the end of the story that he was resurrected, Lazarus was resurrected, but leaving that apart, he couldn't do anything. If we were there, we would think, what is the use of him coming here? That's also we see from Mary who was asking Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. So what is the use of now coming there? What is the use of now Jesus going there? So I try to understand here, taking the second option. If someone would be so close to me, even when I couldn't attend the funeral service, I would still go to the place to see that person, or where the person was buried or cremated, or his ashes have been placed, because I'm deeply connected with that person. So the question that why Jesus was not there before, or someone said, the man who could restore the sight of the blind man, why couldn't he be here to heal or to make this man alive? So these were the questions going around there when Jesus was there, and Jesus wasn't there. More questions would also have arise. So we at times also find this gap or silence of God in our lives, or absence of God in our lives. Like there was this, in this 20th century, a theology came which is known as death of God theology. Here at times in scripture or also in our lives, we find absence of God or silence of God. So there needs a theological understanding for us to grapple this situation. how we understand and cope the absence of God in our lives, the so-called absence of God in our lives, and the so-called silence of God in our lives. Jesus was absent when Mary and Martha, in the words of Mary, if Jesus had been there, her brother would not have died. So they expected Jesus to be there, and Jesus was absent there. They were weeping, and Jesus was not there, or Jesus was silent, even after when he came, when he was there at the place, at the entrance of that town, village where he came. So we see Jesus' silence here, Jesus' absence here. But we cannot stop there. The scripture says he still went there, even after 4 days, when everyone believed nothing could be done. What is the use of Jesus coming after 4 days? But Jesus made sure that he was there with the family at that time. So Jesus is present, God is present, even when we cannot see God, or even when we realize that God is absent in our lives. And God comes to us at the right time to be with us. And God's silence helps us to understand this gap, to struggle with this gap, to struggle with these questions of absence of God and silence of God in our lives, life situations. But still, this passage, this reading ensures us God does not leave us. Jesus comes to us in our lives, in our own life situations. Then we see Jesus being there. So this is one. The second one is what I can learn from these two sisters, Mary and Martha. Sometimes situations put us, make us to ask questions or put us in difficult situation, questioning the existence of God in our lives, especially when we struggle with this absence of God situation, experience in our life. And here we found that we see that they realized Jesus was absent when they needed, when they felt that they needed. And Jesus was silent when they felt that they needed. And then what did these two sisters do there? We find immediately when these two sisters were informed, especially when Mary was informed, the little one was informed, she ran immediately to see, to meet Jesus. And she cries to him. And she also vents out what she had in her mind, in her heart. Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. So this statement can be taken again in two ways. It is also a question. It's a statement, but it's also a question. Why were you not present before? Why didn't you come earlier? Why didn't you save my brother? These were the questions come from Mary's words. But still, we can find this. This can be seen as words of frustration, maybe, or disappointment in Jesus, maybe. But it also has another part to what Mary spoke. It says, Mary trusted in Jesus. Mary still went to Jesus. Mary still relied upon Jesus, depended upon Jesus. Trusting in God in difficult situations. Situations come to us where we are crumbled, we are crushed, and we feel a disconnected relationship with God and Jesus. But here we find she goes to meet Jesus. Jesus comes to her and she goes to Jesus. This disconnection or this gap is being bridged here. And she goes to Jesus and vents out herself. She expresses herself, what is being with her, within her, what is troubling her, what she wanted to speak and say. So she had someone to rely upon at that time. She had someone, Jesus, who came unto her so that she could rely upon this person. She could relate herself with this person, Jesus. She could depend upon this person. So Jesus is available. God is present in our lives when we have this disconnected moments in our lives, in our life situations. God is there, but still invisible. God is silent but still speaking to us. And thirdly, we find from this passage, Jesus wept. We find emotions in this passage. One is, if we read earlier to this passage, to the reading which we read this morning, disciples were telling Jesus, oh, why should we go now? Because they were scared if we go again there, we would be trapped by Jewish authorities or by the Roman soldiers, and it can be also a death situation for disciples and Jesus. So they were scared. Then Jesus goes there, we find. And we find an emotional event happening here. Jesus was crying. I think I would like to keep away the divinity of Jesus and would like to see the humanity of Jesus in here. When we understand Jesus not only as God but as mere human being, then I think we can get more closer to God and Jesus. Jesus crying means that he is with them in their pain, in their suffering, in their weeping and crying. So this is one emotion we identify. Then towards the end of the passage, we identify that they rejoiced when they came to see that their brother was alive. So resurrection also means to us, like we read in Psalm 128, that it starts with weeping, we see it in cries, in tears, but we victoriously and gloriously we rejoice later. Resurrection gives us hope and it liberates us, it transforms us from sadness towards joyfulness, from weeping towards laughing and smiling. And it is also liberating. When Jesus said the final words, unbind him, let him go. These words are words of liberation, liberating us from what we are bound, from what that enslaves us, from what that puts us into a dead situation, a deadly situation. This can be as real as the life being not alive. This can also be the social realities where we are alive but still we are dead spiritually or within or socially. When it comes to empowerment of women, children, downtrodden, or the aboriginals, natives, and other enslaved people, Jesus sets us free. Resurrection is a hope of liberation and salvation. It sets us free, leads us into new life, where this life is, there is no weeping. There is no sorrow, there is no sadness, but only rejoicing and gladness and happiness. We commit our dear ones whom we lost, whom we miss, who departed from our lives, from our life journey. We keep them in the hands of God, and they are in the safe hands of God, being liberated, being set free, who no longer weep, who no longer feel the pain and suffering, but rejoice gladly in the presence of God. May we remember them and thank God for God's liberation in their lives and taking them in God's abode so that they rejoice and see life in fullness. Amen. Shall we pause for a while and ponder upon the words that we just heard?